The arrival process for immigrants was actually quite regulated. They would disembark their ships and make their way through the gangway into the facility, where they would be inspected and sort of examined by Canadian medical officers who would look for visible signs of disease or any particular ailment. If everything was fine, they would then quickly make their way to the assembly hall, and they would sit on benches where they would wait for their name to be called. Then they would have their civil interview, which oftentimes lasted a matter of minutes. They would be sort of asked for their documentation, if they already knew somebody in Canada, if they had any past criminal record, and if they had sort of arranged employment or had brought money with them. And of course, if they were traveling with family, were they with them? How many members were there? After the civil interview, immigrants made their way to the pedway where Canadian customs officers were waiting, and they would sort of inspect their personal belongings, their pockets, their coats, for any contraband items, for example, plants, soils, seeds. Of course, for any excess alcohol and tobacco, if any duty hadn't been paid, then those would be confiscated as well. Once that check was completed, immigrants would make their way across into the annex building, where a lot of the social services, the voluntary aid agencies, such as the Red Cross and the Sisters of Service and the YMCA, were located. Immigrants could oftentimes purchase postcards to write back to their family that they had made it and had landed in Canada. They could buy some food for the train trip that would happen later that day. With the Red Cross Seaport Nursery, for example, they could have their children tended to while their parents grabbed a nap or made arrangements for the rest of their journey. Once they sort of finished in that part of the facility, they made their way down to the ground floor of the annex building, where you would find your checked luggage, so oftentimes really big wooden trunks. And the way that they were actually divided up was by the first letter of your last name. So you'd look on the wall for example, S for Smith. You would find your luggage, and if there was chalk on your luggage, it meant that it had been inspected and that it was okay for you to leave the facility. And it was also there that there was a canteen where you could buy sandwiches and beverages for the train trip to Montreal. Once you got on the train and headed towards Montreal, oftentimes if immigrants weren't staying or relocating to Montreal, they would catch their next train from Montreal to destinations west. So there are a whole host of reasons why someone might be put into detention or have some of their items confiscated. And they oftentimes have to do with just their personal background, the countries that they're coming from. If an immigrant didn't have a prior knowledge of English or French, it could make it very difficult to sort of communicate during the civil interview with a Canadian immigration official. And so that might lead to short-term detention. Other times there was a lack of documentation, or an immigrant arrived with no money. Perhaps they arrived without prearranged employment, or their sponsor hadn't shown up. This would of course cause detention anywhere from a few days up to several months. And so of course the reasons are different for every individual, and it really depended on how prepared and how much of their documentation, their funds and their belongings they had with them when they actually came through the facility. So the voluntary service organizations at Pier 21 were an important aspect of the immigration process through the site. For example, the Sisters of Service, and one particular representative, Sister Salvatrice Leota, she was really important to a lot of immigrants and immigrant families because she sort of helped them navigate the immigration process through the site. So if they didn't speak English or French, she of course would help them. She spoke several languages. She might be able to secure them with food, some childminding, but also attended to their personal and spiritual needs as well. So she was really there to sort of help with any aspect and every aspect of the immigration process through Pier 21. So now I'd like to read a passage from our book, sort of depicting Sister Leota's volunteering at Pier 21 amongst different groups of immigrants. In 1955, Sister Leota, who had been assisting newly arrived immigrants at the Port of Montreal, replaced Sister Kelly at Pier 21. She remembers spending long hours at the immigration shed, anywhere from 18 to 22 hours at a time, to meet immigrants who disembarked from their ships that arrived at all hours of the day and night. Along with Sister Dulashka, Leota arrived an hour ahead of time before a passenger ship docked at Pier 21 so that they could sell stamps, postcards, and stationery. The Catholic Women's League purchased the materials wholesale for the Sisters of Service to sell to immigrants who wished to write home while waiting for their train. Sister Leota also recalls making little cloth bags with drawstrings, which would hold toiletries. These little bags were given as free samples to immigrants who might be in need of some of these basic necessities. Other ditty bags, made of plastic or cellophane, were put together for men and women and included shoelaces, razor blades, ballpoint pencils, bars of soap, a washcloth, and lip balm. Bags included a rosary and a holy picture of Our Mother of Perpetual Help, with a list of Catholic clubs across Canada.